Hi everyone. In this video, we are going to continue our look at the Laplace transform by introducing the Heaviside function. This is also called the unit step function, and the notation I'm using, h of t, you might see that written elsewhere as u of t, u for unit step. So it has two names, but it looks like a pretty basic function. The way we have our standard Heaviside function defined here, we will say that it's 0 to the left of t equals 0, and it's 1 to the right of t equals 0. So you can think of it as stepping from constant 0 to 1 across the value time equals 0. So all it is just a jump discontinuity. What do we use this for? Well, that will become apparent as we work through examples. But the idea is, imagine that you have some kind of signal, like an external forcing function that you want to apply to a harmonic oscillator, but you don't want to apply it right from the start. Maybe you have some spring mass system, and for 5 seconds, it's just following its natural motion. But when time equals 5, you want to flip something on. You can do that with the Heaviside function. So what I would like to do first is plot a few variations of this function so that you can see how to turn something on at a certain time, how to turn it off, and then also how to turn it off and on. So we'll run through some exercises with that. Then we will take a Laplace transform, and I'll talk more about this idea that you can use it to turn on a forcing after some time has gone by. In the sequel to this video, I will solve two ordinary differential equations that involve the Heaviside function. Before I switch over to those graphs, let me make one more remark here, and that is that I didn't give the Heaviside function a particular value at t equals 0, and that's because I didn't want to commit to anything. There are different conventions for that. It's fairly common to say that the Heaviside function is 0 when t is less than 0 and 1 when t is greater than or equal to 0, but that's not universally true. So there are different conventions for how you define the Heaviside function to behave at t equals 0. Because this is a function that we encounter inside of Laplace transforms, it turns out it doesn't really matter. Because if you take the integral of some expression and then you adjust the value of that expression at a single point, you're not going to change the area under the curve. You're not going to change the integral. So you might like this convention, but I won't commit to any particular representation for the Heaviside function at 0. Okay, let's see how we can shift this around in order to turn signals on and off. All right, over here we have a graph of your basic Heaviside function. So it looks like just a jump discontinuity when time equals 0, jumping us from 0 to the left to 1 on the right. What we're going to do is three exercises now where we plot variations of this Heaviside function. Let's start with A. What would it look like if, instead of h of t, I wanted to graph h of t minus 1? Well, just algebraically, that's this function translated one unit to the right. So this is going to be the function which is 0 when t is less than 1 and 1 when t is greater than 1. So you can use this to flip something on when time equals 1. Maybe you have some signal and from 0 to 1 seconds, it's not present. And then when time equals 1, we turn it on by multiplying it with this function. Okay, take a moment on your own now that you've seen the kind of shifting that we're going to do. See if you can work through what the graph of B would look like. So what would it look like if I wanted to graph 1 minus the Heaviside function of t minus 4, h of t minus 4? So let me put up here first h of t minus 4. Just like version A, that's going to be your standard looking Heaviside function, but shifted 4 units to the right. So that would be a switch which gets turned on at t equals 4. Then we negate it, that's going to take what's positive 1 and flip it down to be negative 1. So now we've got 0 and then it switches to negative 1, but then we translate that up by 1. That's that leading 1 here. So our graph transformations overall give us a function which starts off at 1 and then drops down to 0 when time equals 4. So this would be like a signal that turns off when time equals 4. If you imagine some system, you are feeding a signal into it, and then you stop it at time equals 4. That would be the usage of this version of the Heaviside function. Okay, let's put the two Heaviside functions that we have in A and B together. Take a moment again to see if you can work out what the graph of h of t minus 1 minus h of t minus 4 would look like, and then try to interpret what would this be physically. All right, looking at this expression, h of t minus 1 minus h of t minus 4, it's clear that some kind of transition is happening both at time equals 1 and time equals 4. That breaks our time domain up into three regimes, to the left of 1, between 1 and 4, and to the right of 4. So let's look at those cases algebraically. What happens if t is less than 1? Then both of our Heaviside functions are 0. So I'll write h of t minus 1 equals 0 and h of t minus 4 equals 0. So that overall, it's 0, 0 minus 0. Okay, let's go ahead and add that to the plot. So we know what it starts off as. It's 0 to the left of 1. What about between 1 and 4? In this time domain, we are now looking at positive inputs here. So for like t equals 2, this would be h of 1, and that's 1. But here we still have a negative input. So we would have 1 minus 0. I'll just write that, 1 minus 0. So our combination of Heaviside functions gives us overall 1, which we can add to the plot now as the value of this combination between time equals 1 and time equals 4. Now what happens to the right of 4? So if t is greater than, not 0, but 4. In this domain for time, we have positive inputs here and positive inputs here. So both Heaviside functions individually are 1. We are looking at a combination, which gives us 1 minus 1 is 0. So adding that to our plot, our function jumps back down to 0 when time equals 4. So this is like a signal that turns on and then turns off. You flip something on, and then a little bit later, you flipped it off. So that's another option that you can set up with this combination of Heaviside functions. Okay, now let's start talking about Laplace transforms. So I'm going to step away for a second, and then we'll come back and talk more about this idea of taking a signal and modifying it with a Heaviside function. Imagine you have some physical model like a harmonic oscillator, and you would like to apply an external signal to it, but you don't want that signal to appear until, say, a seconds have gone by, where a is greater than 0. How we set this up is we use a product. Define g of t to be the signal that we're going to use. This is going to be the Heaviside function at t minus a, so h of t minus a, times the original signal f evaluated again at t minus a. So we're shifting both the Heaviside function and the original signal f a units to the right. Let's make sure this product does what we need it to. So what happens first for time values smaller than a? Well, if I plug a time value smaller to a into this product, the Heaviside function is going to be evaluated on a negative input. That's going to be 0. So we have 0 times our signal, which is 0. Okay, so this result indicates that our external forcing will not be applied when time is less than a, so before a seconds have gone by. What happens right at the moment when t equals a? Well, when t equals a, we're looking at h of 0 times f of 0. This is just a moment in time. But if you've defined by convention the Heaviside function to be the value 1 at 0, then what we're saying is that our original signal starts when t equals a. So let me write f of 0, assuming that h of 0 is 1. So working with that convention. So notice here that the origin for the original signal has been shifted to a. This is not f of a, it's f of 0. So we've slid how our function behaves at 0 to a. So we've shifted the whole function to the right. And then what happens if time is greater than a? So once we've passed that moment, in this case, we're plugging positive values into the Heaviside function. So that's going to give us 1. And then f of t minus a, whatever that is. So that's just going to be f of t minus a. But again, this whole expression here is being translated. So it's like we're taking our signal as you would normally graph it and just moving it to the right on the t-axis. All right, given that we might want to do this, We might have some system and we don't want to apply a signal until some time has gone by. Let's see how that would affect the Laplace transform. So in other words, if I knew what the Laplace transform of my original signal f of t is, what is the Laplace transform of g, this new signal, in terms of the original signal? All right, let's compare the Laplace transform of g to the Laplace transform of f, where g is just like f, but with a delayed start. So we're going to go all the way back to the original definition of the Laplace transform. The Laplace transform of our new function g is defined as this improper integral from 0 to infinity, e to the negative st times h of t minus a times f of t minus a dt. We know that this expression here is 0 to the left of a, which would make the entire integrand 0. So let's break this computation up into two. We will first integrate from 0 to a, e to the negative st. And now let me go ahead and just write 0 for the Heaviside function. Okay, so we're done with this integral. It's going to be 0. But then to the right of a, we will replace the Heaviside function with 1. Notice it doesn't matter what the Heaviside function is defined to be at a. It's not going to affect either integral because the value of the Heaviside function at a single point, it won't change, you know, the area under the curve for either of these integrands over their respective domains. Okay, there are different ways you could proceed here. You could literally anti-differentiate, or first you could turn it into a limit where you have b as the upper bound of integration, and then you could anti-differentiate and take the limit as b goes to infinity. You could just proceed in a computational way. What I would rather do is recognize that I would like to compare the Laplace transform of g to the Laplace transform of the original function f, which is here. So that indicates that we might want to take this input t minus a and replace it with just a variable input. Normally, I would rather see f of t, but at the risk of variable confusion, I don't want to actually call it t because t already means something here. So let's do a u substitution, which is going to allow this expression to just be replaced with u. So let u be t minus a, then du is just dt. When we change the bounds of integration, the lower bound is going to be 0 because a minus a is 0. And then with improper integrals, you always have to be careful about what happens to the infinite bound. But because this is just a shift, u is t just shifted down by a, like the rate at which we go to infinity is not going to be affected. So we don't have to address this further. It's just going to be like this, except our lower bound is going to drop down to 0. And we're going to be integrating from 0 to infinity. E to the negative s. What was called t should now be called u plus a. F of t minus a is now f of u. That was what motivated this u substitution. And then dt, as we know, is just du, like this. Notice that e to the negative su, e to the negative sa can replace that exponential expression in the integrand. U is what we're integrating with respect to, so this needs to stay in the integral. But s is not what we're integrating with respect to. We've discussed this a lot. This is an integral with respect to t and now with respect to u. So s can be treated like a constant here, and a is literally a constant. So this expression can get pulled in front of the integral. So I will write e to the negative sa times what we had before. But now we're left here with this one, e to the negative su, f of u du. The variable of integration here is u, not t. But if you rewrote this using t instead of u, it would look exactly like the normal definition of the Laplace transform of f of t. So this is the Laplace transform of f. So if you know the Laplace transform of your original signal f, and then you want to delay its start, the Laplace transform of the resulting function, g, is the original Laplace transform, no changes here, but then just scaled in front by this new function e to the negative sa. Take a moment and see if you can work out what just the Laplace transform of the Heaviside function h of t minus a is. So what is the Laplace transform of h of t minus a? Okay, it's a little bit of a trick, but we will say that the Laplace transform of h of t minus a is like the Laplace transform of h of t minus a times 1, the constant function 1. We don't have this quite in the right form for the expressions that we've been looking at, but the idea is imagine that f of t is a constant 1, so that this is f of t minus a, where f of t is 1. Basically, if your function is the constant 1, and then you shift the inputs, it doesn't matter because the output is always 1. So that means that we are now looking at e to the negative sa times, so the answer is that the Laplace transform of the Heaviside function h of t minus a is e to the negative sa times 1 over s. That's the Laplace transform of 1, and it inherits the same domain, so the real part of s should be positive. Now that we've introduced the Heaviside function and worked through some of its properties, we're ready to solve differential equations that have this idea of a delayed external forcing term. So in the next video, we will see first and second order examples.